English setter is of medium height, sleek, lower, and more angled on the limbs compared to the other setters, perhaps the only retriever that reminds us of the Alsatian. The coat is silky, weatherproof, rather long, with a white base that makes it less sensitive to the sun and more visible at a distance, all advantages for a retriever. The great variation in colours and ticking, besides making every dog individual, indicates certain richness and variety of its bloodline, a guarantee for the vitality of the breed. It has an agile build, lean but not too thin, with an ideal weight to power ratio. It is the perfect dog for hunting over any terrain, moving at a long steady pace across the wide lowlands, carefully picking its way among the mountain gorges or climbing nimbly on shale. Even its hunting style is entirely distinct from that of all other retrievers. On picking up the scent, it slowly, smoothly positions itself in the set, crouching and contracted like a spring, ready to flush the game birds, its head pointing towards the prey. In short, a typically feline style, a plastic, inimitable expression showing a strong predatory instinct. The wolf is the common ancestor of four great branches of the canine breeds: leupoid, shepherd dogs; molossoid, watchdogs and cattle dogs; graioid, greyhounds; and bracoid, hunting dogs. The setter is probably the end product of an evolution that started with the hound and the spaniel, as Laverack writes, "My dogs are no more than improved spaniels." It can also be assumed that the border collie has played a part in the creation of the English setter, both in the look, hair type, construction, and in the character, its style when it stops the sheep. The word setter derives from the English verb to set and means what stops, sitting, crouched. There are three kinds of setter: the Gordon setter, the Irish setter, and the English setter, which is by far the most common. Its birth in relatively recent times is linked to the work of the Englishman Sir Edward Laverack, 1798 to 1877, who devoted his whole life to improving this great breed, starting from two dogs that he had acquired in 1825 from Reverend Harrison, Ponto and Moll. He began a careful breeding program, and within a few decades his dogs reached a physical form and hunting style very similar to that existing today. His friend and disciple Purcell Clerwellyn continued his work and consolidated his results, saying, "It is one of the oldest known breeds that we have. No single breed has been so valued by such a large number of eminent sportsmen. I can affirm that I have passed my whole life, now being nearly 73 years, in preserving and maintaining the perfection of this breed." His norms are as follows: a long light head, but not like a snake, that is with convergent sides, or with a wide mouth, but with prominent lips. These dogs are noted for the strong front part to their bodies, a deep, wide rib cage with slanting ribs that reinforce the solid construction of the back up to the beginning of the tail. Extremely strong, wide loins and very slanted shoulders. The tail must be set on the top line, the legs quite short from the hock to the foot, which is well closed and compact. The thighs are particularly well flexed. The colour of the coat is blue-black and punctuated with white. The hair is long, silky and finely woven. The eyes are brown with a sweet and intelligent look, the ears placed low and flat against the head, giving the skull a rounded form. Writing about the dog's retrieving style, Clerwellyn says, "The dog's skill, it was said, was that it could find game a long way away by smelling the air and picking up the scent, better than by following the tracks on the ground. In fact, I am convinced that this dog stopped because of the scent in the air of the fallen bird, and not because of the scent marks and tracks of the bird across the heath." The general appearance is of medium height, with a clean outline that denotes power and elegance without ever seeming too heavy. The skeleton is quite strong with a long musculature, typical of a fast dog accustomed to working in open wild spaces. The trunk forms a rectangle, but the width must not be excessive. The head is dolichocephalic, i.e. the length is 4/10 the dog's height at the withers, and the length of the skull is the same as the muzzle. The facial skull planes are parallel. The stop is pronounced and the lips must not recede. The eyes, in a semi-lateral position, are bright, gentle, intelligent and dark hazel in colour. The nostrils are wide in order to detect even faint smells. The ears are set on low. The neck is smooth with no undulations, with a well-evident break that forms a light collar on the lower base covering the chest. The chest is ample and wide and has strong pectoral muscles, well suited to a dog that requires a lot of air while running. The chest must be deep, with long and convex ribs, curved at the elbow, or better, 2 centimeters under it. The back is straight, with elevated withers that are even more pronounced in the set position. The back joins well with the loins, covered with a strip of powerful elastic muscles, leading into a wide, solid, sloping group with a high-set tail. The tail is medium length, strong and thick at the root, tapering up to the tip. The tail must be well feathered, from about 2 centimeters from the root. The forearm is shorter than the arm, with a length from ground to the elbow equal to that from the elbow to the withers. The shoulders are long and strongly sloped. The tips of the scapular bones almost meet. The elbows are well let down and must not be too close together. The hindquarters have long thighs, strong muscular hocks, and well-pronounced angles in all of the joints. The breed has hare feet, oval with closed curved toes, hard, well-pigmented pads with strong curved toenails. The skin of the English setter is thin and tight, fitting over the muscles without any wrinkles. The coat is fine, silky and smooth, 5 to 6 centimeters long on the trunk and shorter on the head and on the front of the limbs, while much longer with abundant feathering at the base of the neck, on the thighs and legs, on the sternum, on the croup and the tail. The setter is by nature a galloper. Although to the naked eye, the gallop appears to be a series of leaps, the movement is in fact more complex. The animal gathers itself like a spring, then it gives a strong thrust, first with one back limb, then with the other, landing subsequently with the diagonally opposite front leg, immediately followed by the other. There are moments while galloping when the dog is supported by 1, 2, or 3 legs on the ground, and other times when it finds itself entirely in the air, for a time equal to that of the 3 support phases. This happens in the collected gallop, where there is only one suspension phase, when the animal is bent back on itself. In the fast gallop, however, there are 2 suspension phases, one in which the dog is gathered in on itself, and the other when it is fully stretched. In this type of gallop, either 1 or 2 feet touch the ground at a time, since the contact by the second foreleg anticipates the hind leg, rather than following it, as in the collected gallop. The style of gallop naturally depends on the build of the breed, and that of the English setter is somewhat feline. It is a grounded, fluid, and resilient gait that looks effortless. The English setter gallops just grazing the ground, as its spinal column stretches and arches to help the powerful thrust at the back and the exceptional forward stretch of the forelegs. If we were to add together the various bones that make up the setter's forequarters and hindquarters, then compare them with those of any other differently built dog, for example the pointer, we would be amazed to realize that the sum is about the same. difference is in the proportions, in the sense that what the setter loses in forearm and shin bone, it makes up in the humerus and the femur. In fact, the setter has a shorter forearm and leg, but this is compensated by the longer, more slanted arms and thighs. All this gives it an advantage, because it allows it to attain greater results with minimum effort. The reason is that the nearer a part is near to its center of oscillation, the law of the pendulum, the more effective its action will be. 1 centimeter gained on the arms or on the thigh is worth at least 2 centimeters on the forearm or on the leg. The greater angling of the setter while galloping allows it to gather and stretch without flexing or extending the spinal column too much, and without tiring the dog, the result will be a gait a little slower, a heartbeat, but much more elastic and grounded, similar to that of a leopard or a panther. Before starting training for retrieve, it is essential for the puppy to have learned recall well. By nature, the dog is already a gregarious animal and tends not to stray too far from its master. Sometimes, however, caught up in the enthusiasm of a cast, it runs out of sight or, as hunters say, gets out of hand. It should, therefore, be accustomed to come when called as soon as possible. The recall consists of a clear, piercing whistle, since dogs can hear high frequencies best. In order to train it, take the puppy outside, but in a fenced area. While it is playing and exploring the ground at a short distance from you, crouch down and whistle, and at the same time dangle a piece of meat or equivalent titbit. The whistle will immediately attract the dog's attention, and it will turn to look at you out of curiosity. The sight of you crouching will induce the dog to come towards you. As it gets near, it will pick up the smell of the titbit, and it will come to you without delay. Once the whistle-reward connection is established, it will be sufficient to repeat the exercise while increasing the distance between you and the dog will soon come when called, even without the titbit. Next, the dog should be taught to retrieve. Puppies gladly play with sticks or with a small ball that is thrown for them, but often, as they grow older, they gradually lose interest in this pastime if not rewarded. Teaching the dog to retrieve is easy and fun. Shake a small ball, or better still, a knotted handkerchief before the puppy, and once it is really excited, toss the object a couple of meters. While the puppy throws itself headlong onto the object, crouch and wave the usual titbit, and as soon as the dog has picked up the object, recall it with the whistle. Puppies that already know the recall will return at once, too interested in the reward to remember to chew the object, which they will drop in order to take the titbit. The game must be repeated many more times, gradually increasing the distance, but being careful not to bore the dog. After a few lessons, it will bring the object back without a reward. Once the puppy has completely learned the visual retrieve, it can be taught to retrieve by nose, by throwing the ball into tall grass, where the animal will be forced to use its sense of smell to find it. The orders used are fetch and give. When they retrieve, certain dogs show the failing of chewing the game. Others eat it, and some bury it. Such behavior is nearly always the result of incorrect training. To correct the first, some suggest stuffing the fake game with sharp points. But apart from being cruel, this method has the disadvantage of putting the dog off retrieving forever. The fact is that the dogs with a hard bite are usually the result of bad preparation. If they have been used to carrying large, heavy objects, it is natural that they will have learned to tighten their jaws in order to avoid letting the object fall. The ideal teaching aid is a piece of sponge covered in wing feathers. When the puppy grabs this fake game bird between its teeth, it will feel it give and loosen its bite. Other reasons for this bad habit may be a bad relationship with its master, an excessively predatory nature, or even hunger. After the hunt, if the dog is not fed, it will be forced to manage for itself, eating the game instead of retrieving it. When it is clear that the puppy is under control, it reacts perfectly to the recall and it knows the retrieve, finally comes the time to teach it to cast. There is no ideal age to begin, because every dog has an individual character and a different degree of maturity. There are puppies that already point with the effectiveness and the seriousness of an adult, and others still playful and inconclusive. Anyone who has owned a dog, whether a gundog or not, already knows that by nature they tend to scour the ground continuously, tracing diagonals, turning right and left. This enables the dog to sniff deeply, increasing the chance of finding game. Therefore, the training is nothing more than a perfection of a natural tendency, making its search more rational and exact. At this stage, we understand how useful and important the absolute obedience to the whistled recall is. Wait until the puppy is running towards you, and then whistle. At the same time, move diagonally, first to the right and then to the left. Subsequently, associate this movement to the recall and accompany your diagonal movements with gestures of the hands, increasing away the width of the casts. The dog will quickly learn the lesson and will find it entertaining. Here we can see different dogs in action, natural gundogs, whose perfect training serves to illustrate their physical characteristics. These are strong dogs, extremely fit and athletic, that fully express the standard of their breed. After it has located the game, in this case a pheasant, the dog sets off in a good wind. In hunting jargon, that means in the best conditions to detect the scent coming from the game. Now the setter begins its methodical search in perfect style, inspecting the ground in depth with wide diagonal and precise casts, not neglecting any useful area. Then, finally aware of the odor of the game, stands completely still and extremely expressive in the pure style of the breed. While all the other hunting dogs stop on their feet, the setter is the only one that stops crouched, sets, very similar in many ways to a cat aware of the odor of its prey and preparing for the definitive leap. Everything about the setter is elegant and powerful. The tension almost reaches a climax, the muscles straining tight, quivering, and waiting for the magic liberating moment when finally the game breaks cover, the gunshot, and the order to bring back the fallen quarry. We can see the excitement of the animal vibrating in every muscle, the eyes alert and fixed on an imaginary point. The cheeks move just as if to taste the air, tasting every remote scent. Above all, we can see the expressive tail, curving to correctly balance the position of the rest of the body, a tail that seems to speak. It is about a third of the animal's general length. As you can well see, there is an enlargement, the characteristic knot, caused by the hair that is standing due to the extreme tension, and then the tip that vibrates almost imperceptibly like a radar spar. Now the hunter draws near to his dog to entice it to approach the game until the unfortunate bird has no hope of remaining unobserved and is forced to fly out into the open. The approach, under the caressing and firm hand of the master, has a great effect. Only a fraction of the energy contained in the elastic and mighty body of the setter was released by the contact, freeing it from its forced immobility, advancing step after step without losing sight of and concentrating on its quarry. The approach, if done well, must not be confused with the drive, which consists of the dog following the game, which instead of staying still, keeps at the same initial distance on the ground in order. Now, we can observe a busy setter in an exceptional example of setting in flight. In this action, we see all its other prodigious abilities come together in this dog's sense of smell. Forced to search over rough ground, the dog is not able to express its true grounded gallop, but it has to proceed in great leaps. During one of these, while still in the air, it becomes aware of the odor of the game crouched in the vicinity and magnificently manages to land in a set position. The time span in which it picks up the scent and the moment in which it moves into action is merely a fraction of a second. One of the most pleasurable and thrilling experiences for a skilled hunter is to work two well-trained dogs as a brace. To get a good work from the brace, it is necessary that the two dogs do not hinder each other, competing uselessly, and this result is achieved only after a long and exact training, during which the two dogs should have previously been trained independently. The brace work on the so-called crossed cast increases the chances of flushing the game. Here we can see one of the more interesting phenomena, not only of hunting, but of the canine behaviour, revealing a gregarious spirit of the pack that characterises the animal, the so-called endorsement. One of the two dogs alerted to the game stops, and the other is immediately paralysed wherever it is seeking endorsement. This is a classical example of imitation or mimicking, typical of animals that hunt in groups. The second animal, aware of the behaviour of the first, stops its search, which is by now fruitless and would be self-defeating, since it would hinder the action of its companion. In no other sport can we see this behaviour, which far from alterating the instincts of the dog, enhances them and refines them, directing them towards a precise goal. Only in hunting can we see such dog-man symbiosis. Two separate animals become only one creature with six legs and a tail, as the great poet Pablo Neruda said. Past, also known as the Scottish setter, and mentioned in some books as a black setter with tan markings, already in existence in 1726. The history of this field dog originates from setter stock raised in Gordon Castle at the time of Alexander, 4th Duke of Gordon, 1743 to 1827. Since there were no books at that time on the origin or pedigree of dogs, the exact origins of this breed remain unknown. A complete review of all the available testimonies has been published in the book by Major Colin Shilbred. Here we find that the setters in the castle kennels were of various colours, but the black ones, with the tan markings, were preferred for their excellent quality as careful hunters, with a firm set and great resilience. Further crossing brought about a recognised stock. Some writers of the time described these dogs as imposing dogs with a rich fringed coat. White spotting was frequent. Subsequent crossings gradually eliminated the white spotting, and soon there were dogs of solid colour with tan markings. A little white spotting on the chest still appears today in some Gordons, and as long as it is in small size, it does not constitute a defect. The official name then became Black Setter with Tan Markings, and it was with this name that Dandy won the first documented show in Newcastle in 1859. The name Gordon was reused some years after the constitution of the registration system of the British Kennel Club. Seeking the exact beginnings of any breed is always hard work, if not impossible. As already said, the official records date back 100 years, but dogs that could be the ancestors of this setter existed some centuries before. Probably they were not so very different from the spaniel that existed in Spain around the 17th century, arriving in Great Britain with the waves of the soldiers returning from the various wars that were being fought all over the known world. We are not talking about an Espagnol Breton or any other Spaniel as we know them, but rather a dog of similar type to the Espagnol Francaise, physically much closer to today's setter. Spread all over Great Britain, this Spaniel type probably started to assume different characteristics in response to the terrain, the vegetation, the type of hunting, but also because it was valued and in demand by aristocratic families that took charge of breeding. The interesting text by Laverack on the setter provides evidence that different setters existed in the mid-1800s, which can be traced to the various distinguished breeders of setters. In those days, the Gordon setter already showed distinct temperament and characteristics with respect to other setters, characteristics that remain substantially different today. only the founding of the various dog societies in diverse countries brought the definition and the elaboration of the breed standard to the current levels. Therefore, it was only at the end of the 1800s that the official adventure of the Gordon began. The breed was very popular in the 1930s. Then it was overtaken by the English setter, whose spectacular setting made them the uncontested rulers of hunting trials. It has already been said that the breed has Scottish origins. Generally, they have a bigger and heavier head than the other setters. The tail is shorter, of an intense black colour with tan markings. The characteristic that distinguishes them from their English cousins is their strong character, which requires long, hard work in training. When well trained, the Gordon setter is an inimitable hunting dog and very intelligent. They are excellent retrievers. Like the Irish, it points on its feet. But unlike the Irish, the head is parallel or nearly on the ground. It happily works by itself. It is very resilient, slower than its cousins, but more reasonable, giving all its attention to its master and to the hunt. Suited to dirty ground and expert at hunting in the marshes, the mountains are its preferred terrain. When it detects something, it slows its pace and goes upwind, towards the scent. If the game is not there, it starts to walk. If the game is in the area, it slows down, well erect on its legs, the neck outstretched slightly, with the head tall. When it reaches the game, it suddenly stops, erect or straining at the front, never on the back, the tail always well erect. If the game escapes, it follows calmly and at a uniform speed, with a similar gait to the cast. The Gordon setter is a one-man dog and very wary of strangers. An elegant dog built with lines of a galloper, a harmoniously built thoroughbred, it can be compared to a heavy hunter. It must have a symmetrical, perfectly balanced overall build. Strong, rather short, with the back level. Rather short tail, rather long head, with clear lines of intelligent expression, with bright eyes and long flat hair. Head and skull. The head is deeper than it is wide, the muzzle is large and it has a large cranium. The skull is slightly rounded off, and with the maximum space between the ears. The head must have a clearly marked stop, and the length between the occiput and the stop must be slightly longer than that between the stop and the nose. Lean around the eyes, with cheeks as lean as the head allows. The face is quite long, with nearly parallel lines, and not pointed, seen from both the front and the side. The lips are not pendulous, but are cleanly outlined. It has a big black nose, wide with open nostrils. The muzzle must not be as deep as it is long. Eyes. A fair size, not too deep set or too bulging, but sufficiently under the eyebrows to show a careful and intelligent expression. They are dark brown and bright. Ears, set low and closely hanging, thin and of average size. Mouth, must have a scissor bite, not too protruding or receding. The upper teeth must cover the lower one and be well placed in the jaw. Neck, long, lean and arched without any heaviness. Forequarters, long slanted shoulders with a wide flat bone and rather close at the withers. They must not be heavy or too thick, which could interfere with their freedom of movement. Elbows, well placed and visible under the body, which gives freedom to move. Strong forelegs with flat and strong bones, perpendicular, well fringed. Body of average length with a deep chest and ribs that decline. Wide loins, slightly arched. Chest, not too wide. From hip to hock, long, wide and muscular. From hock to feet, strong and short. Stifles well bent, hocks straight, well let down. The pelvis tends to be horizontal. Feet, oval and compact with curved toes and rather a lot of hair between them, well-developed pads. Tail, rather short, straight or slightly scimitar-shaped. Its length must not reach below the hocks. It is carried horizontally or just under the dorsal line. Thick at the root, thinning to a fine point. The feathering, which begins near to the root, must be long and flat and decrease gradually towards the top of the tail. Coat. The hair must be short and fine on the head, on the front part of the limbs and on the bottom of the ears. On all the other parts of the body and on the legs, it should be moderately long, rather flat and as free as possible from curl. The fringe on the top of the ears must be long and silky. Behind the back limbs, it is long and fine. The feathering on the stomach may extend to the chest and the throat. All feathering must be as flat and straight as possible. Colour. Deep, glossy, coal black, without any rust, with tan markings of rich chestnut or mahogany. The marking must be brilliant. The tan marks are clearly outlined over the eyes, on each side of the muzzle, on the throat, the chest, and the inner face of the hindquarters and the thighs. A very small white patch is permissible on the chest. Tan markings, two clear spots over eyes, not over 2 centimeters in diameter, on sides of muzzle, tan not reaching above base of nose, resembling a stripe around clearly defined end of muzzle from one side to the other. Also on throat, two large clear spots on chest, on inside hind legs and inside thighs, showing down front of stifle and broadening out to outside of hind legs from hock to toes, on forelegs, up to elbows behind and to pastern joints or little above, in front, around vent. Very small white spot on chest permissible. Weight and height. The ideal height at the withers for dogs is about 66 centimeters with a weight of about 30 kilograms, while for a bitch the proportions are 62 centimeters and 25 kilograms. Faults. Anything that differs from the above points is considered a fault, and its importance must be considered in proportion to its severity. Note. The dogs must have 2 testicles of normal appearance, well descended in the scrotum. Its ardent and impetuous character is surely the characteristic that makes this splendid animal little valued by hunters. But anyone who is attracted by its elegant gait, the colour of its copper coat, its gallop that recalls a thoroughbred, will have the pleasure of owning a very special gundog. The harmony of its athletic form, its sculpted head and its distinctive lines have often made this superb animal a luxury pet rather than a hunting dog, taking it away from the specialization for which it was originally bred. Its beauty meant that it was often overvalued as a show dog at the expense of its importance as a hunting dog. Today the balance has been redressed. The Irish setter, notes J. Dares, is an elegant dog, beautiful, good and fair, but, he hastens to add, only when it knows the training well. It is commonly thought that the Irish setter or Irish red setter is indigenous to Ireland, the country where red hair predominates in people and animals, but at first the dog's colour was not at all red, but red and white. A French author gives the opinion that the Irish setter is more ancient than that of the English breed, but this theory is not supported by documents found in Britain. The opposite view seems more credible. The Irish setter probably comes from crossbreeding of the English. As far as the setter goes, the prevailing opinion of the more important English authors is that until a certain time, there did not exist just one type of setter, but each single aristocratic family raised and preserved their own dogs on their own land. In 1677, N. Cox wrote of the setters, "Mainly they are white with red ticking, rarely with spotting of the same colour." Over the centuries, clearer and repeated statements established that the setter is white with spots that may be black, yellow or brown. On the other hand, impassioned breeders and enthusiasts of the red setter, like M. Bepler, did not hesitate to affirm that the English setter is the most ancient and the Irish setters come from the English setter. Probably, the setter was imported to Ireland by the English invaders. Environmental reasons, and still more the repeated selections with respect to the colour, have given place to transformations that have made the Irish setter, from the 19th century on, an independent breed. The Reverend H. Mahong, owner of the most famous breeding kennels of the time, in about 1780, describes the setter, of warm red colour with great white spotting. That means that at the time the Irish setter was no longer white with red ticking, but red with white ticking, the first step towards the modern Irish setter. The march toward the solid copper coat continued, and the son of Reverend Mahon continued passionately in his father's footsteps, affirming, "Only in 1835 were the first entirely red setters seen, yet still very rare, and those few dogs were difficult to train." Every care went into the elimination of white, and in spite of the vigilant breeding, it was not uncommon for some dogs in the litters to show white markings of atavistic origin. The phenomenon is to be considered logical even as a natural defense of the breed. Some breeders think that the white marked dogs are generally more docile and easily trainable. It is true that at birth they are generally bigger and stronger. As a hunting dog, the Irish setter has to be carefully chosen, ensuring that the dog comes from a line of hunters and from a suitable breeder in order to avoid unpleasant surprises. After this judicious selection of the origins of the dog, the training is the next test. The handler will require skill, temperament, and technique. It is necessary to understand the temperament of the breed and the character of the dog. The dog's character must be studied thoroughly before undertaking its training. The training requires calm, patience and tenacity. Severity will not pay off. According to Dares, the Irish setter must be trained by its real master. After 30 years of practice, he feels authorized to utter this opinion, since for a long time he has ascertained that it is a one-man dog. This is the reason why he never sent an Irish setter to a dressier, who, though skilled, would never devote enough time to it. On the other hand, after the dog returns from the trainer, the dog will always have to adapt to its owner. And in any case, if the owner does not feel able to train his Irish setter, it is very doubtful that he will have the ability to work correctly with it. This fact perhaps depends on the working qualities of the Irish setter, and it is Sanderson's opinion of that. The Irish setter has many qualities as a hunting dog. It has the walk and the nose, but it is inclined to possess a bony head. While one of our trainers used to say, "This is a beautiful big dog that steals one's heart, and its training is hard work." When well trained, the Irish setter is an inimitable hunting dog with a keen mind. In chases, it has a relentless gallop all of its own, the true gallop of the thoroughbred. It is a tracker of the first order and extremely supple and nimble. Untiring, it can bear the heat, and it has a great resistance in the mountains, in the lowlands, or in swamp areas, where it expresses its ability in aquatic hunting. Some, like Gateski, remember the undisputed truth that the Irish setter must be set to work very early. At 1 year, its training must be completed in the essential elements: obedience, retrieve, down, casting. As a pointer, the English pointer has a better silhouette, but the Irish setter is an excellent retriever for recovering down game birds from marshes. It is a true-to-type light mesomorph with long muscles and sensitive nervous system. The general form is that of an agile athlete whose body is balanced and in harmony with the form. The characteristics of the Irish setter are solid colour coat of rich copper red or bright mahogany. The head has parallel longitudinal facial skull planes, lower outline of the face from the mandible with labial commissure not visible, withers very elevated, eye with oval palpebra. The height of the withers equal to the length of the trunk. Little feet of oval form. Lean construction with fine skeleton but strong. Head. Head long and lean, not narrow or snippy, not coarse at the ears. Skull oval from ear to ear, having plenty of brain room and well-defined occipital protuberance, from occiput to stop and from stop to tip of nose to be parallel and of equal length. Brows raised showing stop. Muzzle moderately deep, fairly square at the end. Jaws of nearly equal length, flews not pendulous, nostrils wide. Nose. The nostrils must be well opened, large and mobile. The nose must be on the same line as the nasal reed, with big planes. Seen in profile, the front face must not project on the vertical front line of the lips. Colour of nose, dark mahogany, dark walnut or black. Nasal reed, straight line, its length and direction related to the axis of the skull. Its width is half its length, it must overcome a little of a third of the length of the nasal reed. Lips and muzzle. The upper lip is thin, close fitting to the jaw, and they recede under the nose, making a semicircle seen from the front. The side walls of the muzzle are parallel, and the front of its face flat, square face. Jaws of normal development, tending to a straight line, with arched jaws that meet perfectly in a scissor bite. Healthy teeth, complete and normally developed. The frontal nose groove. The frontal nose groove is not very pronounced because the sinuses are not developed in the front and at the sides, but they are very prolonged backwards. Eyes. The eyelids are close-fitting to the eyeballs with oval eyelids, the eyeballs neither bulging nor sunken. The eyes must be almond-shaped, well open with a docile look and in a semi-lateral position. The colour of the iris is brown or dark hazel. The pigmentation of the palpebral planes is the same as the nose. Ears. Pendant triangular ears, thin, fine to the touch, set on low and flat. When the head is in a horizontal position, they do not fall more than 2 centimeters below the lower line of the throat. The outside of the ear flap is covered with long silky hair that is up to 2/3 of its length. The tips are covered in short hair. Neck. Moderately long, very muscular, but not too thick. Slightly arched. It must sit cleanly without a break of top line into the shoulders. Body. The trunk has a straight top line gently sloping down from the withers, back lumbar line. Ribs well sprung, leaving plenty of lung room. Although the typical chest of the Irish setter may at first seem rather delicate, its width, in an Irish setter, 60 centimetres at the withers. The chest must measure perimeter 75 centimetres above the elbow, perimeter to the arches of the ribs 64 centimetres, depth 82 centimetres height, 32 centimetres transversal diameter 18 centimetres. The withers are raised with respect to the line of the back. narrow for the length, and come close together at the top of the shoulder blades. The length of the back is about 31% of the height at the withers. The upper line of the back is straight. Back. The withers are raised with respect to the line of the back, narrow for the length, and come close together at the top of the shoulder blades. The length of the back is about 31% of the height at the withers. The upper line of the back is straight. Croup. Long, muscular, wide, showing valleys but not too much, and it must not incline more than 20 degrees above the horizontal. Its length is 1/3 of the height at the withers, and the cross diameter between the two is 1/7 of the height at the withers. Tail. The tail is set high and is carried horizontally or slightly raised. The tail can be straight throughout its length or slightly concave on the upper axis, or like a scimitar. It is thicker at the root and tapers towards the tip. Its length is equal to the height of the front limb at the elbow, and it may go beyond this measurement by a few centimeters. It is fringed in the form of an isosceles triangle, the same color of the coat, and it must start 2 centimeters to 3 centimeters lower than the base of the tail. Sexual organs. Normally developed and in their natural position, the two testicles must be of the same size and held in the scrotum. Coat. Solid color coat of golden red and bright mahogany without the least thread of black. Short and fine on upper portion of the ears, on the back of the forelegs and hind legs, and on top of the tail. A small white mark on the chest in accordance with some dogs of the breed, even on the front or to the toes, although not desired, will not receive a disqualification. Some dog lovers affirm that the Irish setter of red and white coat, blood red and white, was purer in origin than the red solid color. Sir Edward Laverack says it is older and purer. Hair. About 5 centimeters to 6 centimeters long, silky, very straight, with rich feathers, but light, not thick. Long on the body, on the upper part face of the ears, it forms feathers on the backs of the legs, on the sternum, the throat and the tail. Short and fine on the face, on the flaps of the ears, the feet between the toes, which must be well covered with hair. Abundant undercoat only in winter. Its height at the withers in the dogs is 56 centimeters to 64 centimeters and 50 centimeters to 62 centimeters in the bitches. Weight, 20 kilograms to 30 kilograms. Gait when hunting, gallop.
A proper diet is essential to your dog's correct and full development so as to be able to keep it in perfect shape and health. Some people believe that dogs can eat virtually anything and therefore give their dogs all kinds of food, often recycling the leftovers from their own meals. This is a serious mistake since what may be digestible to us and a source of nourishing substances often cannot be digested by dogs or is unable to be metabolized. A final piece of advice. It sometimes happens that a dog loses its appetite and refuses food for 1 or even 2 days. This is a normal occurrence, and in these cases it is a good rule not to always leave a full bowl of food down for the dogs. Instead, the food should be removed after a short time. Present the bowl of food again at the following mealtime after having changed its contents. In the event of loss of appetite lasting for more than 2 days without the presence of side symptoms, or if it is accompanied from the outset by symptoms of general suffering or exhaustion, consult your vet immediately. It is very likely to be an ordinary ailment, but in this case it is not worth taking a risk, and it is better to seek reassurance from an expert. We will now begin with a brief description of a dog's digestive apparatus. As in all carnivores, the stomach is of large dimensions, whereas the intestine is relatively short. Initial digestion in the stomach takes from 3 to 8 hours, then the food passes into the intestine where the nourishing substances are assimilated, which are then transmitted to all the organs through the blood. The stomach's large capacity and the slow digestion process allow abundant meals to be eaten at fairly spaced out intervals. Naturally, to keep dogs in excellent health, it is necessary to provide them with all the elements that they require, that is, proteins, carbohydrates, fats, vitamins, and minerals. When dogs were carnivorous predators, these elements were assimilated by dogs through the animals that they hunted and which were generally herbivores. Afterwards, civilization has led it to feed differently, but it will always be necessary to provide dogs with the appropriate substances. Dogs produce energy from their diet, which is then used for the maintenance of vital functions and movement. The more active a dog is, the greater the energy intake it will require. Without going into detailed food studies that would require a specific treatise, we can simply say that dogs particularly require fats or lipids, both of animal and vegetable origin, and it is these which provide the necessary energy and which accumulate in the organism to provide possible energy reserves. The proteins that make up the large part of the animal's body are also essential. These are indispensable to the formation of all the tissues, especially muscles, and also constitute the basis of hormones and the blood. They therefore represent an irreplaceable element in a proper diet, even more so in puppies, which must build their bodies. Sources of protein are meat, cheese, eggs, and fish, which are well digested by dogs, and also soybean flour, peanuts, legumes, which are, however, digested with more difficulty. An excess of proteins is harmful and can lead to various kinds of disorders, depending on the conditions. Carbohydrates are not essential to a dog's diet. They are, however, very useful at the end of pregnancy. Starch, which is the most important carbohydrate present in the diet, is poorly digested by dogs and needs to undergo preliminary treatment such as cooking, flaking, etc. This is why if you use pasta or rice as a food for your canine friend, it needs to be boiled for a long time to eliminate a large part of the starch present. Fiber, which often accompanies carbohydrates, is especially useful in the diet of sedentary dogs, since it helps to prevent constipation, given the speed with which it passes through the alimentary tract. Vitamins are also necessary, even if in infinitesimal amounts. They are found in many vegetables and are synthesized by herbivorous animals. This is the reason why when a carnivore kills its prey, generally herbivorous, it immediately feeds on the intestines, where there are residues of partially digested vegetable matter. This also explains why, to your considerable annoyance, your dog often eats the excrement of herbivorous animals as soon as it gets the chance. A buildup of vitamins can be harmful, and therefore, if you use pre-prepared feed, you should carefully check the substances contained in the feed before adding supplements, and if in doubt, consult your vet. Minerals are essential to the diet and are supplied by foods. Deficiency in certain minerals such as calcium, iron, potassium, sodium, copper, and others can cause abnormal growth in puppies, also with serious consequences and general debility in adult dogs, or the onset of problems of varying degrees. There is excellent pre-packed feed on the market, both moist and dry types, that provide all the necessary elements for initial growth, and to then keep your dog in top shape. Even if you use pre-packed feed, you will, however, be able to give some fruit or other food which your dog will find tasty, taking care not to exaggerate and not to give harmful substances such as sweets, fried foods, rice dishes, fresh or soft doughy bread that are extremely harmful and which can also have very serious long-term consequences. Instead, if you want to prepare the food yourself, then follow the advice of the breeder who sold you the dog or your vet's advice. As a general rule, it is worth knowing that meat, ideally beef, is essential. If pork meat is given, it must be well cooked in order to avoid infections. Poultry, meat, and rabbit are also fine, provided that they are completely boneless. Giblets, although less rich in nourishing substances, are well liked. Fish is an excellent food and is best given cooked. It is particularly advisable for low-fat diets for dogs with digestive or skin problems. It is also an excellent means with which to make the diet less monotonous. Eggs are appetizing and supply many nourishing substances. They are particularly advisable for puppies and suckling females. Yolks can be consumed raw, whereas the albumen should always be cooked. Fats, such as lard and oil, are always readily accepted by dogs and are particularly useful during moments of work or physical effort. 1 or 2 teaspoonfuls of oil added to food are always beneficial. Dry bread is a good energy source, but it must be well dried. It is also useful for cleaning your dog's teeth and for keeping them in good condition. Pasta and rice are very useful, but as we have already said, they should be cooked very well to eliminate starch, which is not easily digested. Fruit and vegetables, even if not essential, can be given to dogs that appreciate them. However, the nutritional intake is very slight and is only worthy of note for the intake of roughage. Needless to say, the final element which is essential to nutrition is water. Fresh and plentiful, that must be available at all times. If in a bowl, it should be changed as often as possible, especially during hot spells. It is absolutely indispensable to dogs that eat dry and not moistened feed. The final aspect of the diet to take into consideration is the frequency of meals. From birth, puppies have their meals by following times that are spaced out by the instinct of the mother and the other siblings in the litter. The feeds are gradually reduced during weaning and are integrated with suitable foods that should be recommended by an experienced breeder or a vet. Between 1 and 3 months of age, weaned puppies should have 4 meals at regular intervals. From 4 to 7 or 8 months, the number of meals can be reduced to 3, further reduced to 2 meals at 8 to 18 months, and afterwards, if desired, down to just 1 meal a day, even if it is not harmful to continue with 2. On the contrary, this is recommended by certain individuals. The decision to have a dog is an important one to make, which must be thought over carefully without ignoring some useful basic information. The vaccination prophylaxis must always be carried out with utmost care to try and protect not only the puppies but also adult dogs from the most common illnesses. Generally speaking, a puppy leaves the breeder after having been vaccinated at around 40 to 45 days with a triad vaccine against canine distemper, infectious hepatitis, and parvovirus. A second quadrivalent vaccination, also including leptospirosis as well as the 3 ailments already mentioned, is generally carried out after 3 weeks. An additional vaccination can be carried out after a month, again quadrivalent, to be then replaced annually throughout the dog's lifespan. A dog can be vaccinated only if it is in perfect health and thus also free from endoparasites. Appropriate antihelminthic treatment must be carried out normally twice a year. Different types of ascarids exist, each of which specifically infests an animal species, man included, and there is practically no risk of zoonosis, that is, transmission of the infestation from dog to man. It is important that dogs are also kept free from ectoparasites, that is, those that live on dogs such as fleas and mites, both of which are hematophages. Moreover, fleas act as an intermediate host for a type of taenia. Numerous specific products exist to free dogs from these annoying parasites, but one must not forget to also carry out appropriate disinfesting operations in the areas where dogs live. The arrival of spring exacerbates the problems caused by undesired guests, the mites that arrive along with the initial spring warmth. A run in the meadows through woods, perhaps near groups of farmhouses and farms where there is livestock, can result in our canine friend returning home with mites. Not necessarily, since some factors may exist which make a dog more or less susceptible, also depending on its general state of health, that can influence whether or not a dog will pick up these acari. They represent a grave danger to dogs because they transmit pyroplasmosis, a serious infection carried by protozoa of the pyroplasma species that affects pets and also causes death if not discovered and treated in time. The symptoms in its acute form are represented by fever, also sthenic, asthenia, pallor of the apparent mucous membranes, and hyperchromia of the urine that can also become brown-black in color. In advanced cases, jaundice and a comatose state, which could possibly result in death. The mites suck blood for 2 or 3 weeks, and once having mated, the female then detaches itself from the animal and deposits the eggs a week later. The deposited larvae, recognizable by their reddish color, are minute, like tiny beads. They also look for a host on which to climb, sucking blood for several days. They then detach themselves and after a few days change into octoped nymphs of bluish color. They become adults towards August or September. With the arrival of autumn, the adults immediately upon hatching then lay dormant in cracks in the ground until the next spring. In general, the mites attach themselves to less thick skin, such as ears, armpits, groin, between the digits of the paws. Therefore, as a precautionary measure, we should always examine our canine friends for signs of any undesired guests after a walk in the open. Correct dog hygiene starts with coat care. For most breeds, but not all, it is advisable to brush the coat almost daily in order to remove the hairs that have reached the end of their life cycle. The coat of many breeds requires specialized grooming, which is to be carried out several times a year. One must not generalize about the fact that a shiny coat is a sign of good health, since in some breeds it should have a tendency to be dull. Dogs must not be washed too often so as not to damage the protective function of the sebaceous glands. The skin in normal conditions should always look clean without dandruff deposits or desquamations of any kind. Should cutaneous alterations appear, such as eczema, alopecic areas, i.e. hair loss and failure of hair regrowth, thickening or the appearance of abnormal pigmentation, consult your vet without delay. Cutaneous alterations due to mycosis or mange are spread by contagion, but only in the case of particularly debilitated animals and when one fails to observe the most basic hygienic rules. Claws must also be checked periodically. These are normally worn down in dogs that undergo normal physical activities, but it may be necessary to shorten them with the aid of a special tool. Oral hygiene should never be overlooked, and especially in miniature breeds, tartar removal is necessary from time to time because it can cause pyorrhea and bad breath. Certain bones are available on the market that, besides constituting a treat for our four-legged friend, act as a natural toothbrush. In puppies aged between 4 and 6 months, the deciduous dentition is gradually replaced by the permanent one. Regular inspections of the mouth are advisable during this period to check that everything is okay. The existence of cardiopulmonary filariasis, a serious disease caused by a nematode parasite, Dirofilaria imitis, or the blood and heart, has been known for several centuries, as has been known the important transmission mechanism of the disease by the mosquito for about a century. However, it is only in the last 20 years, due to the rapid diffusion of filariasis in dogs kept for company and work dogs, that research institutes, pharmaceutical companies and vets have paid increasing attention to the problem. It is therefore important that dog owners are also aware, even if in general terms, of the existence and phenomena of the parasitosis. The transmission of the disease occurs through the mosquito's sting, which takes up the filaria larvae by sucking blood from an infected subject to then inoculate them into another healthy dog. The high contagiousness of the parasitosis is therefore easily understandable, in addition to its seasonality, spring-summer. During a period of around 6 months, the larvae in the dog's blood grow into adult worms that are situated in the heart and pulmonary arteries. In turn, the adult filariae produce small larvae called microfilariae, which will live in the blood. The dogs most affected are obviously those that spend more or less long periods outside, hence gundogs, work dogs, and those that sleep in the open. The damage induced by the presence of the filariae is of considerable seriousness for that which concerns the cardiocirculatory function, and initially shown as a tendency for dogs to tire easily and the presence of a cough or respiratory dysfunction. The vet giving treatment at this stage will perform different clinical and laboratory tests that will confirm the presence of the parasites. On the contrary, the damage caused by chronic cardiopulmonary filariasis is extremely serious. The alteration of the cardiocirculatory function is often accompanied by liver and kidney lesions and a state of generalized hypersensitivity in the whole organism. The prevention programs that have only been practicable for a few years thanks to the use of specific new drugs are simple to carry out and do not involve toxicity risks for dogs. After having carried out a test to ensure the absence of a previous infestation, the oral administration of a medicine once a month for the duration of the entire hot season will give dogs effective protection, also if they are stung by an infected mosquito.